Good morning and welcome to Glad Tidings Church Online. Welcome to all of our online guests this morning. We would love the opportunity to connect with you. We have a connect card in the video description. Please fill out as much info as you would like and we will be in touch. Good morning also to our church family. Church family, I'm asking you to take just a moment right now and open your Church Center app. Go down to check in, fill in all the bubbles on the left, and go ahead and check your family in this morning as you watch. Again, we're looking for new ways in this new world to better connect with those who are engaging online. Before we get moving this morning, I'd like to make just a few announcements. If you haven't downloaded our new Glad Tidings Church app, please just take a moment and do just that. Again, with this app, you'll have the opportunity to connect with online bulletins, digital content, media, pastors' notes, prayer models. There's a whole lot of goodies in there that you can connect and gain more information to see what the church is up to. So please do that this morning if you haven't already. This coming Wednesday night, we'll be opening up the church sanctuary for prayer from 5 to 8 p.m. We invite you to come and pray. This will be an open prayer meeting so people can come and go according to their schedule. So I would encourage you this Wednesday from 5 to 8, just take some time in between that range and come and seek God and pray for our church and community. I am once again asking our church family to fast and pray for the 3-day run-up to our first service back on Father's Day. So that will be next Thursday through Saturday. I believe that God desires to do some new things within our fellowship and give us fresh vision from the Holy Spirit as He leads us into uncharted territory. So would you join me this coming Thursday through Saturday for a time of fasting and prayer as we head into our first in-person gathering on Father's Day. I want to thank you all again for being a part of our online services. We will be continuing online worship as we transition into in-person gatherings. We will have our online service available for viewing Sundays at 2 p.m. I thank you for your patience and grace in advance as we figure this new thing out together. And I want to do one more thing this morning before we take some time to pray and go into the rest of the service. I can't tilt the camera, so it just is what it is. But I want to take a special moment and thank my beautiful daughter, Jocelyn, who has been here faithfully every week to help her father get through these messages online and put the content up on the screen. So Josie, thank you, baby. I love you. Would you join me this morning as we take some time pray and welcome the Holy Spirit into our online gathering. Lord, we thank you right now for the opportunity to come into your presence. Lord, we welcome your Holy Spirit now. Speak to our hearts, change us from the inside out. Lord, help us be sensitive to your voice and obedient in your leading. We thank you for this day, and God, we thank you that we're, as a church, about to come back together in person. Lord, we eagerly await that. Begin to stir our spirits and prepare us for what you desire to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take the next few moments and worship together.
Blessed be. Yeah.
week from today, we will be coming back together for our first in-person gathering since the middle of March. Can you believe it's been that long already? I sure hope you are ready to come back together. Is expectancy beginning to build in your spirit? I know I'm ready for the body of Christ to be able to come back together in person. As wonderful as technology is, you simply cannot replicate the dynamic of people gathering together in person as the body of Christ and in the name of Jesus. So I'm excited. I hope you are as well. I'm asking again, and I mentioned this in the announcements, but it's worth repeating. I'm asking our church family to again engage in a three-day fast and prayer. That's Thursday through Saturday this coming week as we pray into what God desires to do in and through our Father's Day service. I believe that God is going to heal families on that day. I believe God is going to heal bodies. I believe God is going to give refreshing and new vision to Glad Tidings Church. Would you join me in fasting and prayer for those points of emphasis? Just so we can practice before next week, would you just take a moment right where you are and look at someone close to you and tell them this morning how good they look. Tell them they look good. It's good to see you online. And if right now you're following on Facebook or YouTube, go ahead and text in the comments, hey, y'all looking good this morning. Well, this morning we're going to be continuing our series, Best Sermon Ever, which again is not the best because I'm preaching it. It's the best because Jesus preached it. The Sermon on the Mount is Christ's most detailed and exhaustive sermon while he ministered on this planet. We have tackled a lot of complicated topics over the last several weeks. This one may be a little lighter as far as complication is concerned, but the lesson is just as important as all the others we have examined. Are you ready? Let's begin with our theme verse for this series, and that's Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Maybe you've got it memorized, maybe you don't, but let's follow along together. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. Just take a moment right where you are and ask the Lord to teach you. Lord, we pray that. We ask that right now. Would you teach us today? Teach us your ways. Lord, help us to be students and disciples of Jesus. We thank you right now as you prepare our hearts. Amen. Well, throughout this sermon, Jesus has been laying out the difference between the righteousness of the Pharisees and the righteousness expected by God. I found it interesting, disconcerting, and humbling how many beliefs and practices of the Pharisees are still among us some 2,000 years later. It is so easy to be diverted away from the expectations of God and focus in on the expectations of people. Too often, we find ourselves in bondage to the expectations of people, and we cannot please God and people at the same time. We need to hear from the Holy Spirit and walk in obedience to the lessons of Jesus. Well, starting in chapter 6 of Matthew, Jesus goes into three different expressions of righteousness or righteous acts and will emphasize that our relationship with God must be the basis or the motivation for all three, not the praise of people. Our treasure is found in our obedience in secret. The righteous acts highlighted by Jesus are these three: giving, prayer, and fasting. Why do you do what you do? Why do you give? Why do you pray? Why do you fast? All of these questions take us directly to the motives of our heart. Well, this morning we're going to focus exclusively on giving. So let's go to our specific text for this message. We'll be moving into prayer and fasting in the coming weeks. Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 to 4. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Why do you do what you do? In verse 1, Jesus establishes the primary thought for this next round of instructions to those who would desire to follow him. And essentially, Jesus is saying, examine your motives. Examine your motives. Why do you do what you do? Why do you give? Why do you bless people the way that you do? And let me first express something that we need to understand from this text before we proceed too far. There is an underlying assumption in this text and this instruction from Jesus, an underlying assumption that people do give. Jesus expects his people to give and to give generously. It is a different issue altogether if generosity is not practiced at all. That becomes an issue of selfishness, immaturity, or a lack of faith, among other issues. I've watched over the last several weeks an outpouring of generosity among our body. I cannot tell you how many people have asked if they can just bless someone or bless the church, and they did not want to have their name attached to this extra generosity. They wanted to be secretly generous. It has been very humbling to watch. Generosity done for the right reasons, in the right way, is contagious. We give because God gave first. We bless because we have been blessed. We live with hands open so that God may receive all the glory. Giving is important, but so is motivation of the heart. Many opportunities for motive checks exist in our lives. We just have to be sensitive in those moments to listen for the voice of the Holy Spirit so that he might show us whether our motives are misplaced or not. Here is something all of us can relate to: the giving of gifts. This is a great way to see how we are doing with our generosity. Some of us may love the pageantry of birthdays or Christmas, while others of us can't wait for those days to be over so the expectation of generosity subsides. Do we have anybody watching today who hates giving or receiving presents? You don't have to answer that. Have you ever been to a party of some sort and someone was about to open presents, and one of the pleasant partygoers insisted, "Open my present first. Open mine, open mine." When we give, we must make sure that that mindset does not drive us. We must pay attention to the response in our soul so we don't find ourselves in a place of disappointment because people didn't respond the way we'd hope to the gifts we have given. People are watching. People are watching us. What are they seeing? What do they see in us when we walk out this righteousness? We give because God gave. We don't give to be seen by other people. We've got to examine our motives. We don't need to be recognized for our gifts. If we need recognition, open mine, look at mine first, look what I gave. If we need recognition, then we need to allow the Holy Spirit to search our hearts and change our motivations for giving. Well, let me build upon this thought by giving three important instructions when it comes to giving, when it comes to being generous. Firstly, bless without expectation. Bless without expectation. If we aren't careful, we can allow our generosity to turn into self-centered manipulation by attaching expectations to our gifts. When we bless others, we must do it without attaching any quid pro quo to our generosity. We had a situation in our lives many years ago when someone was generous and allowed us the use of their car while ours was broken down and in need of repair. Not long after we had returned the vehicle, that favor was used against us when we didn't reciprocate as they saw fit. We were being manipulated. The Lord had told them to be generous, but only if we had become their puppet. Generosity cannot come with strings attached if we are going to operate within the heart of God and with the proper motivations. This is an introspective question for each of us directly related to our motivation for blessing other people. Do we attach strings to our blessings and our generosity and our acts of kindness? Do we find ourselves attaching strings and having built-in expectations that when we bless somebody, they need to reciprocate? Does anyone else here hate owing someone something? I know I sure do. And this is something I've struggled with, regardless if someone has blessed us with expectations attached or not. I often have a hard time accepting a blessing from someone because I still have that fear in my soul based upon past events and experiences like the one I just mentioned, wondering why someone is being so nice to us. Are they going to call this blessing in at some point? Do I now owe them something? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? So what I will often do is try to find a way to bless someone back right away so that we are even. That is not how the kingdom of God is set up to function. And I feel like I can belabor this point because I'm talking about me and how I respond. Maybe you don't relate to this at all, but perhaps you do. God wants us to be able to accept the blessings of others because in accepting those blessings, we honor those blessing us, we embrace God's hand in it all, and we don't short-circuit the spirit of generosity. When we try to reciprocate to someone who gave to us so we don't owe them anything, we are actually compromising what God is trying to do in and through their life and ours. They acted in obedience and it didn't attach expectations. The moment we reciprocate without God's directions, expectations then become part of the process and it makes both sides very uncomfortable. Bless without expectations. Let's go to the second point this morning. Bless for the right reasons. Bless for the right reason. You know, there's a cry for authenticity out there, if you haven't noticed. We want the authentic. But in our cry for authenticity, sometimes we can be authentically fake if we aren't careful. If our motives are misplaced, we can be authentically fake and even fool ourselves. We have to bless for the right reason. The call of Christ is to bless people so that their spirit, soul, and body may be enriched and so that God's blessing may be realized. I would be willing to imagine that the blessings most of us have received in life have not come from ravens or random drops of food on the ground or from the mouth of a fish. Am I right? Most of us have not been blessed from those things. Those forms of blessing that we see in Scripture are the rare exceptions of supernatural intervention. The vast, vast majority of the time, God uses people to bless people. This is why we must make sure we are responsive to the leading of the Holy Spirit and obedient in giving. About 15 years ago, Keturah and I moved from the West Coast to the East Coast. At that time, we only had one little one, thank the Lord. That was a long drive. We felt God's call to Richmond, Virginia, to serve on staff at a church and be part of a Christian school. We were young and naive in many ways. We found ourselves as broke as a joke. Has anyone watching ever lived as broke as a joke? You know exactly what I'm talking about when I say broke as a joke. We were broke as a joke. On one occasion, we looked in our refrigerator and kitchen cabinets and realized we had nothing. We had no food unless you consider ketchup and mustard and mayonnaise food. We weren't about to go out and ask for help, and which, you know, looking back, that might have been a prideful thing. I remember this moment vividly, even now, and I will never forget it because God used it to teach me a lesson about both his faithfulness and the generosity of people. Keturah and I didn't know what else to do, so we began opening the kitchen cabinets and the refrigerator and the freezer doors, and we began to command them to be full in the name of Jesus. We knew we had been faithful in tithing off the little that we had, and we practiced generosity to the best of our ability and sacrificially as God asked of us. But in this moment, we needed God to show up somehow. We just kept praying, God, fill our cabinets, be full in the name of Jesus. Not long after we had done that, like later that night, there was a knock on our door. Some new friends of ours from church were standing there holding multiple bags of groceries. They were as sweet and humble as you could possibly imagine. I could tell they did not want to insult us, nor were they there trying to flaunt anything. They simply said that God told them to buy us groceries and get it to us right away. By the time we put everything away in the kitchen, all of our cabinets, our refrigerator, and our freezer were completely full. They were gone. Our friends were gone as quickly as they had came, quickly as they had arrived. And you know what? God received the glory. You see, when we give for the right reason, praise gets directly turned back to God. And our generosity actually becomes a place of memorial in someone's life that helps them reflect on the goodness and faithfulness of God years later, like I just did. That is why we bless for the right reason, because it directs praise back to God, and people have moments they're able to look back and say, God was faithful then. He will be faithful now. Bless for the right reason. And let's go to the last point this morning, and I'm going to close with this point. Bless in secret. Bless in secret. To be truly generous means that we both recognize that everything we own belongs to God, but it also means that we're willing to give what belongs to Him, with only God receiving the glory. I don't need glory for my own generosity. That's what Jesus is communicating through the text. God sees me. God knows me. I would rather be secretly generous and blessed by my Father, who sees all, than be publicly generous and put a lid on my blessings. Jesus said those people that were publicly generous, that flaunted it, that recognition, that was all the reward they were going to get. You know, Jesus also makes reference in this text to not allow the left hand know what the right hand is doing. Obviously, this is not literal. Not sure how that would work, writing a check. The point was this. Do everything possible in your giving to place glory on Christ and to remove attention from yourself. I'm going to say that again. Do everything possible to put all glory on Christ and remove the attention from yourself. And I just hit the TV, so just roll with it. Direct praise back to God with every gift. Your giving meeting practical felt needs in people's lives is an opportunity to present the gospel. And this is where I want to bring all of this to its climax, its main thought. The gospel, lean in real close right now, because this is important about being secretly generous and giving. The gospel is all about giving. So why shouldn't our giving be all about the gospel? The gospel is all about giving. So why shouldn't our giving be all about the gospel? Perhaps some groceries will open someone's heart to Christ. Maybe a gas card will give someone who is struggling find hope that there is a God watching out for them. Maybe there's a young pastoral family like ours was who questioned whether or not they were in God's will until God showed up through people to fill a refrigerator. When we bless in secret, for the right reason, without any strings attached, we paint a picture of the greatest gift of all, Jesus. He is the one who came, lived in obscurity, directed people to his Father, gave his life for all of us, and did it freely so that we might be forgiven. Could it be that our generosity is actually a key to reaching our harvest field? Could it be that our generosity is linked to reaching our community one soul at a time? I believe so. May the Lord search our hearts today and teach us how to live in new levels of generosity and repent of any motivations that displease our Father in heaven. Where might God be asking you to be secretly generous today? Let's just take a moment and ask the Lord to teach us something from this message, that we might be giving and generous with the right motivations, that we would see the opportunities before us, that in giving, we actually present the gospel. Would you join me? Lord, right now, we thank you for this message. We thank you for this teaching from Jesus. God, we pray right now that you would search our hearts, check our motives right now. Holy Spirit, search us. Lord, for those things that we've done in the past, Lord, for attaching strings to our generosity, for having improper motivations, for wanting to be seen and known, God, in these situations and not directing praise back to you, Lord, forgive us today. Forgive us. Lord, teach us to be secretly generous. Teach us, Lord, to have our generosity flow and to be an extension of the gospel. Lord, we thank you because you are a giver. You gave us Jesus. Lord, help us to see, help us to hear, and Lord, help us to respond in faith as you ask us to be generous to people in our lives. God, we give you praise and glory for all the things that you've done in and through us. And God, we thank you right now in this moment for your faithfulness in our lives. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this has been an interesting experience over the last several weeks. I am so excited that next week we will be in this room together. I can't wait. I love you, and I'll see you really soon. God bless.